Good morning, everybody. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers of PCSI for having given me an opportunity to come and talk to you on this particular topic. The topic of my discussion today is CIDs in talk to you on this particular topic. The topic of my discussion today is CIDs in low and middle income countries, impact of the new recommendations. No conflict of interest. So the scope of my discussion includes the need for guidelines, CID in India and Asia, core penetrance of these guidelines, CID, what is our data, and CID in specific situations. If you look at the objective of this guideline, they have noted that the purpose of this document is to provide guidance to clinicians for one, the management of pediatric patients who may require a CID, with the primary focus on the indications for device implantations. In fact, the very objective is to spell out the indications for device implantations in the pediatric patients. Now, if you look at the ICD penetrations across geographies, you can see that the US has an ICD implant rate of nearly 550 per million. The Western geography, such as Germany, has about 250 per million. The UK has about 70 to 80 per million, while India and China has got roughly about 2 to 4 per million. Now, you can obviously see that this difference among the geographies is probably related to the economic pattern of these economies, as seen in this graph. Now, if you look at the low ICD access in emerging geographies, you can see that there is a low penetration of these ICDs, be it China, Middle East, Latin America, India, or the Asian countries, and it has a penetration of around 1 to 4%. The cost of ICDs for primary prevention may be prohibitive in these developing economies. Why is the penetration variable in these varying economies? Now, the acceptance of primary prevention data is inadequate. The guideline penetration is poor among the cardiologist, and the clinical need for primary prevention is not really convincing, as you know, the immediate mortality is actually not evident. We have economic reasons, and there is a paucity of geography-specific data. So, for Indian data, you need actually to convince the Indian clinicians. Now, if you look at the awareness of indications for device therapy among a broad range of physicians in a survey study conducted in Europe, you can see that when you take cardiologists, internists, and family physicians, nearly 50% of them were unaware of indications. And this will be all the more accentuated when you take the pediatric range of both physicians as well as the indications. So let us now look at some specific indications. The congenital complete heart block in the pediatric age group. Now, permanent pacemaker implantation is indicated for patients with congenital complete AV block with symptomatic bradycardia. Now, it is a class 1 indication for patients with congenital complete heart block in asymptomatic neonates or infants when the mean ventricular rate is less than 50 beats per minute. It is a class 2A indication for pacemaker implantation in asymptomatic complete heart block beyond the first year of life when the mean ventricular rate is less than 50 beats per minute or there are prolonged pauses in the ventricular. So to clarify a little further, an average ventricular rate of less than 50 beats per minute is a threshold which is recommended for neonatal and infant pacemaker implantation in the absence of low cardiac output symptoms. And this threshold is 60 to 70 beats per minute in the presence of congenital heart disease. Now, beyond first year, with the indication is with for symptomatic bradycardia or less than 50 beats per minute, if the child is asymptomatic. Now, we looked at our data of pacemaker implantation in congenital heart disease at our center, which is a major center in the south. We had about 225 patients, which is not a big number when you take the number of years, about 20 years actually this data is there. Now, age at implantation was 8, 50% were males. Less than 1 month, we had 22 children, and 1 month to 1 year, 33. Now, the main diagnosis at implantation was congenital complete heart block in 50% of the patients. If you look at the implant rate in this graph, you can see there is a sudden increase in the number of implants after 2010. This, of course, is not really related to the changing profile of the pediatric cardiologist after 2010, nor to the onset of new guidelines, but actually it is more related to the appearance of government-supported schemes, thereby indicating that economies, economic support does play an important role in the pacemaker implants. The data in PPI in neonates in our center showed that we had about 22 patients. Median age was 2 days, median weight was 3 kg, and the average heart rate was 46 beats per minute. When you look at the ICD and CRT in the young, one can realize that sudden cardiac death in childhood and adolescence is associated with three primary forms of cardiovascular disease. One, the congenital heart disease. Two, the cardiomyopathies. And three, the genetic arrhythmia syndromes. Now, prospective identification and treatment of these young patients who are at risk for sudden cardiac arrest is crucial, because now, when you compare with adults, only a very low percentage of patients, of children who undergo resuscitation, actually survive to hospital discharge. Now, the indications for ICD in arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy, it is simple and straightforward in these guidelines. And it is a class 1 indication for ICD implantation in patients with arrhythmogenic cardiomyopathy who have been resuscitated from sudden cardiac arrest or VT that is hemodynamically unstable. And it is a class 2 indication if the VT is sustained and hemodynamically stable or with an ejection fraction of less than 35%. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the sudden cardiac rates are 1 to 7% per year. The risk factors for sudden cardiac death are actually different than the pediatric age group. Specifically, risk factors like LG and genetic testing are not really correlative in children. So it is a class 1 implantation, it is a class 1 indication for ICD implantation in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in patients who are survivors of sudden cardiac arrest or who have spontaneous sustained VT. Now, ICD in congenital heart disease. The risk factors include ventricular dysfunction and abnormal hemodynamics. Now, correction of these residual hemodynamic abnormalities or RF ablation of these arrhythmic substrate may prevent VT. Now, ICD is indicated for sudden cardiac arrest and hemodynamically unstable VT. In situations like post-op tetralogy, where VT ablation can be successfully done and it can be a permanent cure and should be offered with EPS to confirm non-inducibility, and thereby you can prevent an ICD implant. So the guideline indications for ICD in congenital heart disease typified by situations like post-op tetralogy. Now, it is a class 1 indication for ICD implant in congenital heart disease patients who are survivors of sudden cardiac arrest or who have hemodynamically unstable sustained VT. And it is a class 2 indication for congenital heart disease with sustained VT or ejection fraction less than 35%. We looked at our data in ICD in the pediatric age group, and there were not many patients. We had only about 5 patients, of which 2 were for primary indications. And this does reflect the referral patterns. So one can see that the source of referrals, which are the physicians or the pediatricians, unless they are convinced by the guidelines, we will not be having a significant number of implants. Now, looking at the CRT in pediatric patients, which is an important point that has been discussed, CRT is currently a class 1 indication for heart failure of class 3 by 4, ejection fraction less than 35%, and left bundle branch block with a QRS duration of more than 140 milliseconds. Now, it is indicated in systemic LV dysfunction typified by dilated cardiomyopathy or congenital complete heart block. Systemic RV dysfunction in situations like atrial switch with sending a mustard or corrected TGA, and single ventricle situations like with Fontan, or post-op RV dysfunction such as typified by post-op tetralogy. Now, we looked at our CRT data under 18 years of age, and again here there were not many patients. We had about 4 or 5 patients, which of course is understandable, and the indications were non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, congenital complete heart block, post-op tetralogy, and we had a single ventricle. Coming to CRT in single ventricles, now single ventricle is predisposed to ventricular dysfunction, and it is related to pressure overload or volume overload and poor myocardial protection during surgery. Multi-site pacing can reduce the QRS duration and improve ejection fraction. Now, we have done a double-site pacing for single ventricle and have shown improvement in ejection fraction. Now, Kicini et al. Has shown that of 13 patients that he has done, there is a reduction in QRS duration, improvement in ejection fraction, and significant clinical improvement. But that, of course, has not been uniformly accurate. So in conclusion, guideline penetration is vital for success. The device implant rate is related to the acceptance of guidelines by the cardiologist. Geography-related data based on trials is vital to convince the clinician. Now, economic constraints needs to be taken care of for a successful program. And as of today, a lot of governments have taken up this and has successfully incorporated into the system. This new guideline will certainly have a favorable impact. Thank you.